And Father, we just give you praise and glory. What awesome days it is to be alive and serving you, Lord. We're just so grateful. Thank you for your grace and your favor. Thank you for the grace and favor on our lives and our homes and our families, on this nation, this awesome nation, Lord, on our churches. And Father, it's not by might and it's not by power, but it's by your Spirit, Lord. It's by your Spirit. And we just welcome the Holy Spirit into the service in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. In Acts chapter 20, I've been spending a lot of time last time I was even here in this passage of Scripture. And Paul here, you know, is about to, embark onto the next part of his life. He doesn't even know what's really going to be confronting him. But he says in verse 22, and see, now I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me there, except the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me. But none of these things move me, and I love that. And nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I might finish my race or my course with joy. I like that. Now, this is the great Apostle Paul here. He could have said he wanted to finish his course or his race with great healing signs, and that'd be good. Great apostolic meetings, and that'd be good. Great prophetic words, but he didn't say that. He said that he might finish his course with joy. You know, as I say, if I can just say, you know, and I'm not talking about your church, I'm just talking generally, but I just find that today a large percentage of people don't finish anything. Thank you for your enthusiasm. Yep. I thought that would be over real well. You know, but we live in a society, very transient, very society, and people don't stay in the same jobs. No. They don't stay in the same marriages. Now, look, if you're divorced, put your stones down, don't throw, you know. You can't unscramble eggs. But you know, is that right or not? I mean, I know people that have been married three or four times, had a couple of concubines and porcupines besides, and nobody gives a rip. Thank you for your enthusiasm, and that's even in ministry. My mum and dad were married to each other for 72 years. They're only Christians 10 years. 72 years to each other. You know, I never ever heard my father use the term divorce, murder, lots of times. But you know, I remember my dad saying when you got married to her, it was till death do us part, not till somebody better comes along. You know, so a lot of people just don't finish anything, even in the church, they don't finish. They start off like skyrockets, everything's wonderful, that's right, and they just disappear. Where we live on the Gold Coast now, I mean, it just bothers me so much that I see so many people just come and go, and marriages, and you know, even people that just quit the job. And you know, it seems to me that if we could just, you know, they think that happiness is a place. If I could just live there, if I could just live there, you know, if I could just live in Hawaii, if I could just live in Bali. Well, how many of you know when you go to Bali, you took your biggest problem with you? You.
That's right.
How do you get away from you? You look in the mirror, you're still there. Oh, thank you. Is that right or not? So it's not so much a place as that it's something that comes from within, inside of us. You know, we were in Bali a couple of years ago, actually, for our anniversary, and I'll never forget, half the Aussies want to go there, half the Balinese want to live in Australia. They're pleading, they're saying, oh, I work 60 hours a week and I've got six kids, and if I could just get to Australia, the land of milk and honey. And I said, swim out and catch the boat, leaves every morning at 9 o'clock. We won't go there, is that right or not? So he says that I might finish my race or my course with joy. I like that. And I shared last time I was here, Nehemiah tells us the joy of the Lord is your strength. Yes. If you lose your joy, you will lose your strength.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just seeing so many people today, you know, they're disheartened, you know, they're discouraged, people are depressed. Anybody know suicide is rampant? I don't know about your nation, it's certainly rampant in mine. And you know, everybody's looking somewhere else. It gets better later on. Okay? Anyway, so he goes on to say here that I might finish my course with joy. And then he says something else. And the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. That's what he wants to do for the rest of his life. And I may have shared before, but the word grace is the word charis or charismatic. But the word joy is chara. There's only one letter difference between the two. Both come from the same root word, actually, in the Greek. And so I began to realize that grace and joy go together. I actually believe that grace is the source of your joy. You get a revelation of how much God loves you, just like you are. Warts and all. Is that right or not?
Yes.
I'm sitting in Joseph's church some years ago and I hear the voice of God say, I love you. I even like you. I know all about you anyway. Is that right or not? So grace can be measured by the degree of joy, I believe, that's in your life. And he says that I might finish my course with joy. But as I say, a lot of people just don't seem to finish anything. They start off, I tell my grandsons, you know, finish what you start. If you're going to start it, finish it. Is that right or not? I've got one in the army now and things like that, but stick the course. My grandson rang me up, he's 18 years old, and he says, Pop, I got a sergeant standing here spitting in my face, calling me a maggot. I said, well, all he wants to do is see if you're going to quit. If you're going to quit, they want to see if you're going to quit. I said, if you just stay with it, a week down the road, he'll pick on somebody else. And that's exactly what happened. Is that right or not? And so, you know, and as I say, some people don't finish anything. If you go to Romans with me, Romans chapter 1, and here, again, Paul's writing. I like, as I say, I like the way Paul writes. And he says here, if we might pick it up in verse 20, he's talking about, for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal powers and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Everybody knows there is a God.
Yes.
You only have to look at these beautiful blossoms, is that right or not? And they just didn't happen to come into being. And he goes on to say, and one of the reasons I really believe that, you know, some people don't finish their course is because of what he says in verse 21. He says, because they, although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God. Is that right or not? Nor, it says, were they thankful. There's something just about being thankful. You know, you people have every reason to be thankful living in this country.
Yes.
I travel a lot, I can tell you right now, is that right? You live in the second best country. No, I'm just joking. Just joking. But you live in a beautiful country. No one's starving to death. No one's threatening to cut your head off tomorrow, blow you up. We just had an email from some friends in the Middle East. You know, that ISIS is going around and they're trying to find people that have converted to Christianity. They get the kids. Are you a Christian? Kill them on the spot.
Yeah.
Just kill them on the spot. You never woke up to that this morning.
No, we didn't.
You didn't wake up in Afghanistan or somewhere else. You know, the worst problem that you have, 95% of the world would change places with you now. Can I have an amen?
Yes.
Thank you for your enthusiasm. Is that right? But it says they weren't thankful. I just find a lot of people today just aren't thankful about it. Man, I'm married to one of the most beautiful ladies in the world. I've got awesome kids. My son has just been presented with the Australian Police Medal. That's the same as a doctorate. You know, sold a horrific murder, presented by the governor. I flew up there. I mean, 6'3". You know, I'm shaking hands with his kneecap. I'm so proud, you know. My grandsons, my granddaughters. It's just, you know, there's so much to be. Is it right?
Yes.
To be thankful for. Just be thankful. He says that's one of the reasons. And he goes on and says, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. If I can read it to you in the Amplified, it means a little bit clearer. It says, because although they knew and recognized him as God, they did not honor or glorify him as God, or even give thanks to him. But instead they become futile and godless in their thinking, with their vain imaginations and foolish reasonings and stupid speculations. I was just thinking about that. You know, what's imagination got to do? You know, if you begin to understand how the spirit man works, you know, and I believe if we do it God's way, if we're so grateful to God, is that right? Anybody know? And we're so thankful. Paul talks about rejoicing in the Lord and being thankful. It begins, you'll find that your imagination, the creative part of your mind begins to work in favor of you instead of against you. Let me give you, how many of you know Paul talks about that the grace of God might not be in vain?
Yeah.
That I don't frustrate. Well, how could you frustrate the grace of God? Simply, I believe, because we don't believe it.
Yes.
You know, a lot of people, if I could just say this, and this helped me a lot, when we first got started, you know, and you read, and people do it today, they read 10 chapters of the Bible to sort of impress God, you wouldn't remember one thing you read. If you're honest, tomorrow you wouldn't even read. But you know, you take passages of Scripture that speak to specifically to you. One passage, and we begin to meditate that over and over and over until it gets from your head down into your heart. And it begins to impact your heart. The language of the heart is images. It's not words, it's images. Your heart thinks in pictures. If I say dog, nobody sees the word D-O-G. If you do, we'll lay hands on your head. It doesn't work properly. You see a dog, usually your dog. But if I say I've got a boxer, the image changes completely. Words, is that right? create images. The more word, the better the image. As I say here, you know, the Bible talks so much about that. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 7 says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. It doesn't matter what I think about you, it's the way you see yourself. You know, Jewish boys at 13 go through a thing called bar mitzvah. They become men. They don't have teenagers. Their boys become men. Paul writes, when I was a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, at 13 years of age, they go through bar mitzvah. And they say, welcome to manhood. In Western society, we don't even know, oh, God, I was going to go there, what a man is anymore. We think it's just, well, I was born a man. No, you were born a male. You become a man when you accept the responsibilities that go with manhood. And so these young men, I've been in a bar mitzvah, and what's these pimply-faced 13-year-old kids, you know, they dance around, hold them up, granddad, dad, rabbis, and all that, and they say, welcome to manhood. You talk to this pimply-faced little kid afterwards, and he says, today I've become a man. I want to laugh. But it doesn't matter what I think of him, it's what he thinks about himself. The way he sees himself. And there are people in the church that see themselves sick. No matter what you say, they have a sickness image. Many have a failure image. It may not even be their fault. It's been imprinted into them over a lifetime. I was reading Tiger Woods. And you know, when he said, from the very first moment I can remember, my father told me I'd be the greatest golfer in the world. And that's exactly what he became. And I remember another fellow that I met in jail, and he said, my father told me I'll never amount to anything, and that's exactly what happened to me. It builds an image inside of a person. Is that right? No matter what you get. Yeah, and you know, you try with all of your ability in the natural, but something inside of you keeps dragging you back. It's like the autopilot of a plane. And the pilot gets on, is that right, take off, and they put it on autopilot. And it flies at a certain speed and a certain direction. Is that correct or not? Now, you can get up there and you can gain control of the plane and bring it around like this. But the moment you release the pressure, the control, it will come straight back. I'm with the autopilot. The image of your heart is the autopilot for your life. As a man thinketh in his heart. So you imagine if we actually began to meditate scriptures that we're so blessed of God. We actually begin to work with the Word of God. Hello, that He loves me. Can I have an amen or what? That you're blessed, that you're favored. I love the way the Jews talk to the young people. They call it empowering. We call it blessings. They speak blessings over their children. And they actually believe they're empowering, that everything you turn your hand to shall prosper and succeed. You'll be the head, not the tail, and above and not beneath. You imagine what sort of image that would build into a person. Even Jesus needed it. When he comes up out of the waters of baptism, he has not even conducted, he's not even had one miracle. And a voice from heaven says, this is my beloved son. That's identification. This is who you are. In whom I'm what? Well pleased. Not you're an idiot going nowhere. So, you know, as I say here, I began to realize, you know, what he's saying here, the reason that their imaginations have become futile, many of them didn't last the distance, is because I believe their imagination started to work against them. Instead of them seeing the blessings of God, is that right, the favor of God, they see themselves the exact opposite. You know, anyway, you know, the Bible talks about, anyway, we won't go into there either, but I'm not talking about fantasy, I'm talking about the part of your heart that thinks in dreams and images. There's two sides of the brain, left brain, right brain. Some people know brain, just as happy. But the Bible talks about left brain. It's actually in the Word. It actually talks about dialogismos, the side of the brain that thinks logically. Is that right or not? You see a truck coming down the street, you better think logically, which would be a grease spot on the road. But when you come to the things of the Spirit, there's another side. It's called dianoia, the part of the image that thinks, the part of the mind that thinks in dreams and visions and images. The part that creates. And I say, I believe it's the language of the Spirit. You know, the more that I began to look, it changed my life. Look at Matthew with me, Matthew chapter 5. How many of you believe the Bible?
Amen.
You know, as I say, I pastor 50 pastors in different nations, and it bothers me when I see churches, when I see people, when their lives are coming to nothing, or suicides, or marriage breakups. I want to know why. What is behind this? I know it's demonic, but in fact, Matthew chapter 5, verse 28, you know, Jesus here talking, and he says that, but I say to you, whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Now, my first question would be to the Lord, well, how could that someone be guilty for something that hasn't even taken place in the natural? Nothing even. It says you only have to look. to lust upon. So an image forms in your heart and you're guilty of. Is that right or not? Hello? How can you be guilty of? Because it's conceiving something already in the spirit man. It's like a seed. Remember, you're with a child. You know, you see a baby. That baby just didn't come into existence. It was some seed sown. It was conceived. And over a 9-month period, is that right or not? It was begin to be created. Listen to me. The imagination is the womb of your spirit.
Yes.
It grabs a hold of the promises of God and begins to conceive them inside of you. You know, I talk to people and they come out. We had a lady, I pastored in the United States for a couple of years. And I remember we had a pastor's wife that was in a wheelchair. And so, you know, she's coming up and I said to her, I believe it's God. I said to her one night, I said, you know, have you ever seen yourself out of that wheelchair? And she looked at me like I'm some sort of a fruitcake. She said, what? I said, have you ever seen yourself out of that wheelchair? And she said, no. And I said, if you never see yourself out of it, you'll never get out of it. I'm not just talking physically. I'm talking with the eyes of your heart. I said, I believe this. I said, I believe if you find scriptures that deal with healing and you go home and you start to meditate them day after day, you forget about reading all the other, but just stay with it day after day. I said, eventually it will drop from your head to your heart. I said, you know what? I believe you could get out of this wheelchair. I said to her, I said, I believe that you could get out of this wheelchair before next Sunday. As God is my witness. Next Sunday rolls around and she rolls up in the wheelchair. And she looks up and she says, oh, I said, how's it going? She said, oh, Pastor, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I thought, what have you done? She said, you know, you told me that if I really got that word in my heart, I'd get out of the wheelchair on Sunday. And I said, yes. She said, I got out last Wednesday. And stood up and walked. Man, we had ourselves a meeting. Now, if you don't believe that, it's entirely up to you. But Jesus says, if a man looks upon a woman, he's already guilty. It's all, something has already been conceived in that man's spirit. You know, there's scripture after scripture that deal with, you know, in Hebrew, that word is yes, yetzer. It talks about the part of the mind that is creative. In Greek, it's dianoia. Go to Genesis chapter 11 with me. Let me show you what I'm talking about here. And some people are looking at me real strange. No, I'm not talking New Age. I'm talking New Testament. Hello? You know, when I first learned about, it's funny, I got saved, you know, and I first started reading about meditating. And I thought, well, that meant like you're up in Afghanistan in some cave going, om, om, om. That's what I thought meditate meant. Some weird people, the orange people, the bald-headed ones, you know. And then I learned that it's been in the scriptures for thousands of years. In Genesis chapter 6, if I can find it here, and it says here, what's the passage of scripture? Let's start off here. Oh, no, I'm on the wrong passage. Give me a moment. I'll pick it up. I think I've jotted down the wrong. Oh, Genesis 11. Did I say 6?
No, you said 6.
Okay, look here with me anyway. We'll pick it up. And pick it, verse 1. Now the whole earth had one language and one speech. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. Then they said come to one another, come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly. That they had bricks for stone, and they had asphalt for mortar. And they said, come, let's build ourselves a city, a tower whose top reaches into the very heavens. We couldn't probably even do that today. And it says here, let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the earth. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, everybody say the Lord said, the Lord said, indeed the people are one, and all they have one language. Is that right? And this which they have begin to do, and nothing, is that right? Nothing from which they have imagined.
Yeah.
Read it for yourself. Will be withheld from them.
Yeah.
How powerful is it when God's very will is threatened by men's imagination? He said, if we don't, they're seeing the same thing, they're saying the same thing. Is that right or not?
Yeah.
If we don't do something about this, whatever they have imagined to do will be created. That changed my life. I remember, you know, at the time we had a church of maybe 100 people, maybe a few more, and I'm believing God for a bigger church, and everything I tried to do, nothing seemed to happen. I was just doing it in my own strength. But I remember the Spirit of God speaking to me. He said, you know, think about this. When you go to your prayer meetings, he said, you're praying for this, and this one's praying for that. Someone's praying for Aunt Gertie, and they're praying for their dog, and the fleas on the dog, and everything else. You know, everybody's praying for their own things. What you need is unity. That you need to be seeing the same thing and saying the same thing. Is that right? This is what he's talking about here. And so I get up at our prayer meetings and I say, now close your eyes. Can you see this church filled to capacity? Can you see every seat filled? Can you see the parking places out there? Listen to me, that if you don't get here an hour earlier, you don't even get a place. The church that we're talking about here that we went over, when I first went, they had 100 people. Now they have 34,000 people. And they ask, please only come to one service. We can't handle the people. I was there in a meeting. I married the pastor and his wife. They had less than 100 people. Today, we were there one time. They took up a spontaneous offering to pass on to somebody else, $20 million. Hello? And I began to realize, man, you know, they got excited. I started to see it inside of myself. I closed my eyes and I can see my church built. And so we were having a combined service in Darwin at the time. And they were using our facilities. And so all the other churches came in. We had 700, 800, 1,000 people filled the buildings, people standing up. And I got up to introduce everybody, you know, and the Spirit of God said, now you can see it in reality. Put this into your heart. And every time you start to speak it, start to see this. You know what? Within 2 years, we had a church of 400 people. And it just kept going. I'd like to say, oh, you're beauty. It wasn't me. God did it in spite of me. Anybody know what I'm talking about here? Yeah. And I began to realize, oh, this is awesome. I did it at the time, or before I was saved. You know, I owned a gun shop in Darwin. Not the normal for ministry, you know. But, you know, and then we sold our business. And before I started in ministry, I started doing wildlife safari, taking people out, photography. I love eagles. Taking people out to photograph eagles and things like that. But I'd take some people hunting. You know, at the time I wanted to be Crocodile Dundee. You know, but I had a major problem with fear. I just couldn't snap out. You know, I was a hypochondriac. If I got the sniffles, if I got a few symptoms, you'd get me around somebody with some symptoms. And 3 days later, I'd have the same sickness. I'd just latch onto it and I'd start to see all of those symptoms. You know, and all of a sudden I realised this is not real good for Crocodile Dundee, you know. And take my wife out to help me get the boat down and all those sort of things. So I found passages of Scripture dealing with fear. God has not given to me a spirit of fear. One of power and of love and of a sound mind. I didn't read anything for 3 months. I never even read a newspaper. I just got passages of Scripture. And I'd lay down, I'd start to see myself, the righteous are as bold as a lion. And week after week. And then I started noticing changes. Well, I started finding I'm lining up with what God's Word has already said. It's not enough to read it once, that'll be good. And then, you know, forget about it. I spent months and months. Now listen to me, how many of you know in the moment, the crisis of life, whatever is in your heart will come out. If you've just been watching Sesame Street, you better whistle up Big Bird. You've been reading Playboy, Hugh Hefner's about to show up. I don't mean to be rude, but that's why many Christians in a crisis, amaze us what comes out. That's what you've been putting in. You go to hospital, people dying of cancer, and I'd say, put these scriptures on and listen to them over. And you come back, they got the scriptures turned off and they're watching as the stomach turns on TV. There's no wonder what's happening anyway. And so I'm just it changed my life forever. And I'm meditating and it's building me up, and all of a sudden, whoa, you know, you could run through a wall and jump over a troop, is that right? But you know, I'm taking people out hunting. I took this group of Asian people that wanted to shoot wild pigs. So we go out. I bought myself a brand new camera, 500mm telelens, and I didn't know how it worked properly. So we jump out of the four-wheel drive, there's all these wild pigs running. I mean, you've got boars and pigs over here, you know what I'm talking about. One of these guys picks up the rifle and hits one, hits it in the side of the head just enough to make it angry. And it turns and charges us. Now, I'm oblivious to all this. I'm trying to work my camera out. He drops the rifle and climbs a tree. And I'm trying, oh, yeah, well, there's a one. And I look up and here comes this pig, flat out. Now, a miracle's wonderful about a week after it happened. This thing's coming straight at me, you know. Well, in a crisis, your mind doesn't work. If you've been in a car smash, it just locks up. Whatever's in your heart will come out. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Don't look at me so super spiritual. Watch out, your halos don't slip down and strangle you to death. You know what I'm talking about. You may not like it, but you do know what I'm talking about. And this pig's coming straight at me. I'll never forget this. You know, my head just checks out. I hear this coming out of my heart. I'm not trying to make up a power of positive thinking. It's just flowing out of my spirit. God has not given you a spirit of fear. with a power and of love and of sound mind. Whoa! And I hear this voice say, when I tell you kick, kick, and I went whack, and I hit this pig right in the face. And I ended up going tunnel. It hurt me. You know, it didn't even phase the pig. It just blew a bit of snot and a couple of other things. It's all happening in fractions of seconds. I mean, you know, and this pig comes a second time, and woof, I hit him a second time. You know, the third time, I hear this voice inside of me say, when I tell you, kick, give it everything you got. And I did, but I mistimed. I went upstairs, went flat on my back. I'm rolling in the mud with this pig. I'm not saying it's a giant boar, but it was enough to make do some damage. And the pig gets up and shakes his head and runs off. And I'm standing there. And my head checks back in. I said, that's the dumbest thing I've ever seen in my life, you idiot. You could have lost half your foot. I said, yeah, well, where were you when I needed you? Hello. The bloke up the tree says, Jungle Jim, crocodile. And I'm just a young Christian. I said, I kick pigs in the face all the time. And God said, you're a liar. You need a change of underclothes. And I did. And this pig's bolting. I learned more from that than from Bible school. This pig's bolting away, and I'm going, whoa, this is awesome or what? See, listen to me. Once you've experienced the Word of God, they can't talk you out of it.
No, that's right.
It's too late. Don't shake my tree. I'm happy. I might be nuts, but I'm happy now. So you know what I'm talking about. You know, but it was an image I had. I'm not being smart. It was an image I had in my heart. I put months and months into building that image inside of me. You want to know why some people don't make it? They don't glorify God. They're not thankful. They're not focusing on the things of God and thanking God for all these. Is that right? That you're blessed and you're called and you're healed and you're favored. Is that right or not? We're just focusing on the negatives and how come it's me or not me or whatever. You know, and as I began to realize, you know, focusing on that Word of God. And meditating and building it into your heart until it starts to come alive. Man, I don't know about you, but I love that sort of stuff. Yes. You know, can you see yourself? Just close your eyes. Can you see yourself favored of God? Yes. You know, Jen's dad, he used to say, everything I buy is a lemon. And it was. The car would break down, the fridge, and I'd say, how come that is always you? You know, and he says, everything I buy is a lemon. Because that's what he believed. There are people like that. See, hope, is that right? Your imagination gives you hope. It begins to create something in front of you that is hope. Hope, is that right or not? That gives you something to add your faith to. The Bible says a people without a vision perish. If there's no vision there. You know, whoever built this building had a blueprint. First of all, they had some sort of image. Before ever, it was inside a person and they wrote it down. They drew it into a blueprint before they ever built it. And it's the same with your life, I believe that. You know, can you start to get an image of yourself blessed and favored and called of God? If you don't have it, you know what amazes me, and I've seen this from people in my church. They're going to retire at 65. And they're going to do this and they're going to do that. You know, one man wished to work for Qantas and he was in my church. He said, when I retire and I'm going to do this, and at 65 he retired, within a year he was dead. There's nothing more to live for. Everything that he had wanted to do was fulfilled, was completed. There was nothing there out there. You know, always have a goal out there in front of you. Always have something. Is that right? Even if you don't need it for yourself, somebody else does. My sister right now is battling cancer, stage 4 cancer of the lungs. And she's saved, but she doesn't know a lot about the Word of God. And so my wife and I have been going down there sitting, and she loves, I can't think of the Italian opera singer, you know, the blind Italian opera singer, I can't think of his name, but she loves him. And so I said, what we need to do, I said, you know, let's get some tickets for that concert. It was going to be held a few weeks ago. And I said, let's start to, you know, I sat on a bed and I said, let's just see yourself at that concert. See yourself for that, enjoying that concert. And my sister said, the doctor said, I can't get it. I said, the doctor's not God. I know he thinks he is, but he ain't God. Can I have an amen or what? I said, you know, listen to me. I said, let's get an image. Let's have a goal. 2 weeks ago, she went to the concert. Was right through the concert. And so now I'm saying, now we need to see ourselves for Christmas. Let's see Christmas. And all the kids and the grandkids are coming for Christmas. Let's have a goal, a short-term goal, a long-term. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? My associate pastor, his father was diagnosed with cancer 35 years ago. And the doctor said to him, I'm sorry, Mr. Dawson, but you'll be dead in 6 months. He said, I'll be alive to bury you, Doc. And he was. He lived into his 90s. And if you're just going to, I don't mean to be rude, but if you just listen to what anybody's going to, they'll put you in your grave real quick. What you need, somebody, listen to me, and it's the Word of God that has ability, is that right, to transform the way you even see yourself. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. There are people with failure images, sickness images, all sorts, you know, and it's hard to shake that. I'm just being honest, it is hard to shake that. But the Word of God will, is that right? Can, you know, start glorifying God, start magnifying the Lord. You know, Jan and I are very normal height as you, but I've got a 6'3", son. A detective. Where's a Glock 9mm strapped on his ankle? Hello? He's married to a police officer. We got Dirty Harry and Dirty Harriet. When my son was 11, my wife got him in. We were just learning this. And she said, I'm going to have one son over 6 foot and you're it. And she just kept saying it and kept saying it. And I'm watching my son. He came in and says, Mum, stop. I'll be a giraffe. Stop. 6'3". My wife was there, I wouldn't be able to say this, but my eldest daughter is built like Sabrina. I'm telling you, Dolly Parton. But she was flat as a board. And she came in and she said to Mum, she said, oh, look at me, look what you did for Mark, can you help me? She came to my wife and said, I want to have a reduction. She said, you're not having anything reduced. That was gone. I'm seeing it in the natural. Don't look at me so superficial. I'm just trying to help you. We had a mango tree in Darwin and it never produced mangoes. And while I'm standing upstairs one day, Jen comes out and kicks the mango tree. She said, you're supposed to produce mangoes. And she said, look at the Greek's tree down there hanging over with mangoes. She said, if you don't start producing mangoes, next day, I'm going to cut you down. As God is my witness, we had a tree of mangoes next year. If you don't believe it, let your mango tree go bare. You know, I'm not making things up. I'm telling you what the Word of God says. People think it's New Age. It's not New Age. It's New Testament. It's been here in Scripture. Is that right? And just allowing the Word of God to transform the way you see yourself. The way you transform your kids. Imagine speaking blessings over your kids. I told my grandsons, you can be anything you want to be. You can be the Prime Minister of this country. I got a 14-year-old grandson, and he wanted a job. He goes to Officeworks and applies with 95 other people. He's only a kid at school. 95, he gets the job. And so on, I'll never forget. And he says, hey, Pop, the manager likes me. And so about 2 weeks later, he gets called in and someone's written a letter about him. He got called in the manager's office and the manager said, I've got a letter about you. He thinks he's going to get in trouble. He said, this old lady wrote and said, that young man has restored my faith in this generation. I said, what did you say? He said, I was just nice to her. I just built her up. I carried her bags. But you know what? He knew he was going to get that job. He said to me, Pop, I'll have that job's mine. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You think, well, he's a smart act. No, he's not even like that at all. You know, he's just got that confidence. I'm favored of God. I'm blessed of God. Can I have an amen or what? You know, it's just working, as Paul talks about, working with the Word of God instead of working against the Word of God. You know, as I say, start glorifying God. Look at Ephesians. Let me give you a couple of scriptures here before we close tonight. Ephesians. How many of you do believe the Bible?
Amen.
In Ephesians here somewhere. Thank you, Jesus. I can't find it. Here it is, Ephesians chapter 1. And it says here in verse 17, familiar passage of Scripture. It says here, let's read verse 15. Therefore also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I don't cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him. That the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe.
Yes,
there are three things there that hang on the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. The number one is knowing the hope of your calling.
Yeah.
Number two, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance as saints? Number three, what is exceeding all greatness of his power towards us that believe. All of that hang on the eyes of your understanding being lightened. Most of us don't even know what the eyes of our understanding are. I'm not being rude, I'm just being honest. If you do a word study, you'll find he's talking about the dianoia, the part of your spirit that thinks in images, where it begins to line up the eyes of your understanding. See, there are eyes of your spirit. The Bible talks about that. Let me read you a couple of other things here from Scripture. And I know that you'll be familiar with these Scriptures. This is from Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh or the senses. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds.
Amen.
Now I wonder what the strongholds. Casting down imaginations. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And having in readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. And do not look on the things after the outward appearance. Mm-hmm. Now if you don't look on the outward, there's only one way you can look, and that's on the inward. Can I have an amen or what? The scripture after scripture, as I say, talking about this. Let me read you another one here from 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1. And it says in verse 13, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Now think about that. Gird up. That word gird up actually has come from the Greek word zonomi, which means to bind about by constant repetition. Like you would take the dress that they used to wear and you'd wrap it around and tack it in. It says that you bind up, he says here, by constant repetition. Well, what's the loins of your mind? Now think about it. What would be the loins? Well, first of all, think what the loins are. The loins house the reproductive organs of your body. The sexual organs are in the... Is that right? That's where you conceive in the natural.
Yeah.
So there is a natural conception. There is a spiritual conception. He's talking about the part of your mind that has the ability to conceive a miracle.
Mm-hmm.
To give birth in the spirit. And the seed is the word of God. The same as the seed is a sperm for a natural baby. It's the word of God. And we begin to get it in. We actual conception in your spirit. An image starts to take place. That's why Jesus said, if you see it in your heart, you're guilty of it already. Lusting. Is that right or not? And I began to see this. You know, just taking the word of God. You're blessed of God. You're favored of God. Is that right? Think about that. You're the apple of God's eye. Love. Unconditional. Unmerited. Favor and love. Think about that. Rather than working against it, you're a mongrel going to hell. Think about it. You know, a couple of years ago, I go to a barber where we live on the Gold Coast. Rough as bags. Every second word's a swear word. If you took the swear words out of his vocabulary, it would be struck dumb. I mean, he breaks up words with an expletive in the middle, kangaroo expletive roo in the middle. You know, I rough as guts, but anyway, I go there because he's a good barber. I go and he's away and there's a lady barber. She's rougher than he is. And I get all cranky, tattoos everywhere. If you've got a tattoo, that's kind, that's fine. I don't want one. Would you slap a bumper sticker on a Ferrari? Anyway, you won't go there. But you know what? You know, I'm just thinking about this, you know. And I go there and she's swearing and... And I'm sitting up the back and she looks at me and she says, what do you do for a living? Can I share this? Never apologise for your values.
No.
Just have the guts. Never apologise for your values. I said, I'm a minister of the gospel. And so the language changed immediately. Isn't this amazing? All the swearing stopped. This is not the first time I've heard bad language. It won't be the last time. But it stops. And now, you know, all of a sudden she picks on God. And God did this and God did that. And I can see she's got a poor image of God. I says, just stop, lady. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me. I said, look. Because they don't look at you. I said, look at me. I said, God loves you just like you are. And she stopped. Now, if I said you're a mongrel going to hell, she's heard that. I said, look at me, lady. God loves you just like you. And she said, well, you don't even know what I've done. I said, it's not based on what we've done. It's based on accepting what he's done for us.
That's right.
Amen. If it's based on what we've done, I don't qualify.
No.
Now, you wouldn't have to be a rocket scientist today. Think about this. Every religion on the planet is based on what you do.
Yes.
If you're a Muslim, you've got to pray 5 times a day facing Mecca. That's bondage to me. I wouldn't... Anyway. If you're is that Buddhist, do certain things. Old Testament Christianity, do good, get good, do bad, get bad. Seventh Day Adventist, go on a certain day. All of it is based on you performing. But only New Testament Christianity is not based on anything you do or can do. It's based on accepting what he's done for us.
Amen.
Paid the price once and for all. All he says is believe in your heart and confess with your mouth. You will be saved.
Amen.
Believe in your heart is not just absent thought. It's been in your spirit, man, that you believe that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Amen.
And so I said, lady, look at me. I said, she started to cry. The barbers all look at me. I never touched it. Never laid a hand on her. She's howling in the... So, 2 weeks later, she shows up at church. I never even invite... I never ask her. She just comes to church. As far as I know, she's still going to church. Because she saw the goodness of God. It's the goodness of God that brings me into repentance.
Right.
So I go back a couple of weeks later and she's away and the barber's back there again and he sees me and he brushes through the people and he comes up and he says, "Hey Cole, that must be one hell of a church." He said, "Whatever happened to hell, it must be one hell of a church." I said, "Well, it must be about time you came." He said, "It's not that bad yet." And how do you take somebody, I mean, every second word's a swear word, to a lady that just automatically comes to church? We didn't drag her along. I didn't even invite her to church. She just turns up at church. Because she's looking for, is that right? For some love, for some acceptance. Just, is that right? Just even being worthy. Most people, all they want, anyway. So I'm just thinking about this, you know, what is it? What can we do, you know, with the people that just, they're not finishing anything, they don't finish the, you know, one of my closest friends, or Jan's closest friend, she's known, they grew up together, they were friends next door to each other. And they've been married for 40 years, and the husband just came home recently and says, "I don't want to be married anymore." He said, "There's nobody else, I just don't want the responsibility of marriage anymore," and walks out. Just like that. Don't look at me, super spirits. I'm just telling you the truth. But it says here that Paul says, "I might finish my course with joy." Yeah. Do you think he might have had a few problems? He's beaten up. He's stoned. That's not marijuana. He's left for dead. I believe he was dead. I believe they prayed him back. But is that right or not? But he has a revelation of the grace of God, the goodness of God. And he says that, is that right? That the grace of God may not be in vain. That I might not frustrate. Why? That he'll begin to work with it and not against it. Hello?
Yeah.
Magnifying God.
Yeah.
Not yourself. You know, this is the most selfish generation we have. I feel the love's going to come in. This is the most selfish generation. We're in love with our mirrors. If anybody else fell in love with us, we'd get jealous. Is this too deep? What does the Bible say for the predominant sign of the last days? Forget 666 and the stormtroopers are coming. It says men will be lovers of themselves. I mean, hello? Is that right? Everything. We even have things called iPhones and iPads because it's about I. Everything's about me. What's in this for me? And it's in the church as well. I sat on my dad's bed, 72 years married. I said, "Dad, how can you stay married to the same lad?" He looked at me and said, "Just learn to be less selfish." See, that would halve the divorce rate, that one thing alone, just one thing. You know, I mean, I love this generation. I've got grandkids, 8 grandkids. But, you know, they're so woefully, inadequately prepared for marriage. I mean, all they think is it's Hollywood. You know, is that right? They don't even plan a marriage. They plan a wedding. Everything's a wedding.
That's right.
Well, what about when the wedding's finished? What about one day when you wake up and looks are gone? You look over, E.T. phone home, E.T. go home. Is this as good as it's going to get? That better be, is that right? Don't tell me it's not going to happen. What kids? Is that right? What holds it together now? What holds it together now? Do I lie? Do I lie?
Oh,
you know, it's so woefully inadequate. So I'm saying to my dad, how do you stay married for all those years? You know, my dad grew up in a large family, 12 kids in the family. First up was best dressed. When they had the longest arm, ate the most. Sleep in a bed with 6 kids, half went to bed, the other half turned out to be great swimmers. I can't say that, I just said it. But you don't grow up selfish. I guarantee you don't grow up selfish. You get it knocked out. And so that's why we need the church. For many people, this is the extended family. This is the only family some people will ever know. In our own church, we had heaps of, you know, single parents, single, you know, on Christmas Day, we used to invite them to our home for lunch, and there were dozens of these people. And they'd say, "The church is my family. This is the only family that I really know." Is that right or not? Hello? It's an extended family. And no matter how bad you think you've got it, there's always somebody that needs help more than you do. He's talking about they didn't glorify God. And they were not thankful. You know, you have so much to be thankful for. You really do. Is that right or not?
Yes.
And as I say here, just working, allowing that word of God, you know, gird up the loins, gird up by constant repetition, taking the word of God. Not what some ding-a-ling said, what the actual Bible does say, the goodness of God, the grace of God. Find the passages that deal with your problem. If it's healing or provision, whatever it needs, and find the passages and then start to meditate them. Psalms 1 talks about that. To Joshua, is that right? Sorry, to David. Joshua chapter 1 talks about that. Meditate on my word. Don't tell me you can't do it. You know, it's called worry in the negative. Is that right? Hey, don't tell me you can't do it. It's like learning those dumb, stupid Western songs. Clingity, clang, dingity, dang, and shot my girlfriend and stole my horse. I shot my horse and stole my... Don't tell me you can't do it. Do I lie?
No.
You go, and the thing's still... Those rotten advertisements, but
yes.
They're real catchy sometimes, and you're going, but this thing's going in my head. Is that right? But that's how you just take passages and you meditate them.
Yes.
Over and over. I think the greatest leap I've ever had in my own spiritual life was when I learned to meditate Scripture. It changed my life.
Yes.
It really did change my life. If I can just share that with you. And allowing the grace of God. Let's close off. Go to Psalm 37 with me. Psalm 37. How many of you still believe the Bible?
Amen.
In Psalm 37. Maybe, and I'm sure you've looked at this before, but maybe we could just look slightly differently. In Psalm 37... And let's read verse 4. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. You know how most times we've read that, if I could be brutally frank. You know, delight yourself in the Lord. You know, and when the green light in heaven, that you've been accepted enough of God, bing, there you got your new car. It's not saying that. It's not saying that at all. You know what He's actually saying here? If you delight yourself in the Lord, you know, you begin to worship God, you begin to glorify God, and you're grateful, the desires of your heart will come from Him.
Yes.
Not your own that He's just going to drop, but you'll find that the desires that come into your heart will actually be from God.
Amen.
Delight yourself in the Lord. Is that right?
Yeah.
And He will give you the desires of your heart.
That's right.
Maybe just a little slight different interpretation, but a whole lot different to the meaning. You get people out there, I'll never forget when we first started, we were in Word of Faith, and people, you know, they're believing for 3 oil wells or the Queen Mary. You don't even have a job. But one guy came to me and said, oh, God's going to give me the desire of my heart. I desire somebody else's wife. I said, you're an idiot. Don't you love it? Oh, man. Man, you know, I'm going to say because I'm leaving anyway. You know, common sense is not all that common. I passed it a long time. I had people ring me at 3:00 in the morning. Did I wake you, Pastor? No, I'm just sitting here listening. What do you reckon I'd be doing at 3:00 in the morning? Do you have any brains? One guy rang me at 3:00. Do you have a word for me? Yeah, but you won't want to hear it. Trust me, you will not want to hear it. You know, I didn't grow up in the church, you know. Common sense is not all that common. Anyway. Oh, thank you, Jesus. There's people out there in the church, they can brighten up any room simply by leaving it. I don't want to be one. Delight yourself in the Lord. Not just self. Delight yourself in the Lord. Paul says that the reason that it's not working for them is, number one, even though they knew God, they didn't glorify God. So that means they're glorifying themselves. It's all about me. He says, and they're not thankful. You know, you have so much to be thankful for. Really you do. Beautiful country, no one's starving to death. Is that right or not? Just think, you know, thank you, Jesus. I go to a lot of third world countries. You know what? Your bathroom is bigger than many of the whole house in many countries. I know what's he called? The Pope kisses the tarmac when he comes home. I would too. It's just such a privilege, a blessing.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. Where's the Philippine? My daughter-in-law's Filipina, so I love the Filipino people, but it's stinking hot. And we got a little stinking hot. You know? And I never forget this. I'm staying with the pastor and the pastor's son. And every morning, like, the water gets cut off about 7:00, so he'd get up and use all the water. And I get up to have a shower, and I get up there, lather myself with the soap, no water. It's stinking hot. I mean, eventually I'm walking into the church and raise my arms and people are fainting. But I'm at 4 days, I couldn't get a shower. I'm getting ticked off with this. I'm getting really ticked off with this. You know what I'm saying? I think, I went home, I remember arriving home and Jan comes to give me a hug and she says, whoa, you haven't heard of water. I said, shut up. But you know, just to have a shower. Just to go home and take some of them as simple as a shower. Is that right or not? I mean, we just take it so much for granted. Is that right or not? I mean, you know, as I say, just in third, some people are living in packing cases. But you know, and I'll close off with this, but I was in Margaret Court's church last year at a conference, and this third world pastor from an African country, I've never met him before in my life, he comes up and we're talking. He said, you know what? He said, as soon as I got off the plane, the first thing I noticed is no joy in your country. And I said, what? He said, walk up the street and look at people's faces and tell me how many people you see are smiling. Most of us got a scowl on our face. Do I lie? What? You know what I love to do now? I like to get on the lift and spin around and go. And the people go. And it embarrasses them. They get off the lift and walk over there. They think you're an axe murderer or something. I just stand there. You know, I mean, like, what? No. I know I got a warped sense of humour. I mean, just be grateful. The one thing I remember, and you know, my mum and dad married. My dad was badly shot up in the war with Japan. My dad couldn't work for 2 years. My memories, early memories, my dad couldn't work. But it was always a sense of humour. You know, it was always, what I believe what kept my family together was just a sense of humour. Just that ability to laugh. And we've just lost that. We just seem to don't even appreciate some of those things, you know, just even being grateful. Humour. I think I shared last time I was here, I love people that can make you laugh. I love people that just got a, you know, just got that sense of humour, you know, just that, anyway, can change your life. God speaks so much about that, the joy, just being joyful. Rejoice in the Lord always, Philippians says. Paul was in jail when he wrote that. He's chained to a Roman guard. He writes to the church at Philippi and says, rejoice in the Lord. And again, I say rejoice. Most of us can't even rejoice when things are going bad. I mean, when things are going good. I'm allowed fourth closing, as they say. I lost my house in Cyclone Tracy, 1974. We built a brand new home. We'd been in it 6 months in the middle of the night, roof's lifting, and my wife's crying. She's saying, honey, my curtains are being ruined. Next day, my house, it's gone with the wind. All I got is a elevated dance floor with one wall. I grabbed my kids, my four kids, our little kids, run across to the neighbor. I'm running over power lines that are down. I don't even know if they're alive. If they're alive, I'm dead. We run under the table, you know, we run next door, throwing the kids under the table. There's two or three other families that have come too. We're all under the table. The room exploded, the roof went off, the ceilings came, and they trapped us for 6 hours. There's water, there's glass, people screaming out. For 6 hours, I thought I'm dead. I made my peace with God. You know, after 6 hours, we dig our way out. Nothing left but Hiroshima. Nothing. You know, people killed in the street. Absolute 11,000 houses destroyed. You know, and I'm in shock. But I still love people. That awkward sense of humour. I'm under a table, you know, like this. Other people's arms and legs are all intertangled like this because we're all huddling together. And after 6 hours, you lose the feeling in your limbs. I can't feel my legs. I said, Jan, I can't feel my legs. I can't feel my... This lady next to me said, if you don't stop playing with my legs, I'll slap your face. I'm pinching some shears there. I wonder, I can't feel it's not my leg. And I couldn't help it. I just started laughing. And then I saw that lady about 3 years later. She said, do you remember me? And I said, face is familiar. She said, you're playing with my leg. But it makes so much difference. I mean, you know, I went back and it's just the wreckage of my house. You know, I'm in shock. How many of you know when you're in shock, your brain doesn't work? I mean, I'm just caught up in my whole world. You know, and I'm staring out into outer space. I'll never forget. And a teenage boy is walking down the street. And he's whistling. He looks up and says, morning, Cole, having breakfast on the patio today. I said, what? I said, all I've got is a patio, you idiot. I said, give me a brick, I'll kill him. Happy Acres Mental Home. Blown down. I couldn't help but start. And I'm laughing and he's laughing. And Jan thinks I'm ready for cutting out paper dolls now. But we're laughing at each other. And I hear the voice of God. I'm sure God was trying to speak to me before, but I'm so wrapped up in myself, I don't hear it. I hear the voice of God say, you're alive. Your wife's alive. Your kids are alive. Your dog doesn't have a scratch. Just be thankful. Just be grateful. That changed my life. Just be thankful. Is that maybe not everything's going on? Is that right? But you've got a lot to be thankful for.
Amen.
That we might glorify God and be thankful. Is that right? That our imaginations, that the part of our spirit man that produces will begin to work for us, not against us. That we might not frustrate the grace of God. May not be in vain. That we might finish our course with joy. Wouldn't that be awesome?
Amen.
That when it was time to check out, that you finished your course with joy. Wouldn't it be better to die laughing than to die crying? I believe it would. You know, anyway. Thank you, Jesus. Let's look to the Lord. Father, we just give you praise and we give you glory. I pray for every man, woman, every child, every home, every family that's represented here. And Lord, thank you. We have so much to be grateful for. Thank you for the privilege of being alive and serving you in these days in this beautiful country of New Zealand, Lord. Father, no one's going hungry. No one's starving to death. Lord, we have so much that you've given to us, and most of us are just not even appreciative or thankful for it. If I could just have a bigger car, if I could have a bigger house, if I had a better job, if I lived somewhere else. But Father, I believe that the devil gets into our lives and destroys our joy. And then once that joy goes, so goes our strength. Father, we worship you, Almighty God, awesome God. Thank you for your grace and your favour on our homes and our families, on the church, on the nation. We just give you the praise and we give you the glory. We worship you, Lord. We magnify your name. Thank you, Jesus. Why do heads are bowed and nobody's looking around just for a moment? This is not to do with anybody else. It's just purely between you and God. But is there anybody here tonight that you don't know God? You've never accepted Jesus as your Lord? I'm not asking you to join a church. Simply pass from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. If there's anyone there, just pop your hand up to signify, pray for me. I'd like to. I won't embarrass you. I won't drag you down front. I'll just pray for you right where you're sitting. Is there anyone at all? Just slip your hand up and say, please, Pastor, would you pray for me? Anyone at all? Thank you, Jesus. And I'll pray for you right where you're sitting right now.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Worship you, Lord. Magnify you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Then I want you to stand up with me, everybody. Would you stand up? Oh, thank you, Lord. Raise your hands up with me. Will you say this out of your heart? Say, I'm a believer.
I'm a believer.
I'm not a doubter.
I'm not a doubter.
Thank you for your grace.
Thank you for your grace.
Thank you for your favor.
Thank you for your favor.
It's on my life.
It's on my life.
My family.
My family.
My nation.
My nation.
On my church.
On my church.
And Father, I believe.
I
expect.
I
will.
In the coming days.
Glorify you.
Glorify you.
Not myself.
Not myself.
But I'll glorify you.
Glorify you.
Lord, forgive me.
Lord, forgive me.
For not being thankful.
For not being thankful.
And having so much to be thankful for. But from now on. I'll give thanks.
I
will rejoice.
I'll
rejoice in the Lord always. Father, I believe.
As
I begin to believe right,
and
I begin to think right,
it
begins to cause my imagination. The part of my mind that creates
to work for me.
And not against me.
And not against me.
As I meditate your word,
not just my own thoughts,
but meditate your word.
Delight myself in you.
The desires of my heart
will be created.
They'll come from you.
And I thank you for it.
I just give you the praise.
I just give you the glory.
And I thank you.
and I thank you.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.